pastor, missionary, evangelist, Brother John Hemus. Amen. All the way from Liverpool, England. Amen. We are delighted he and his lovely wife, Sister Sherry, are here. And they are soon going back to England. But before they went, they came to see the folks that love them the most. And we're glad they're here. Give them a big hand. God did some wonderful things the last time they were with us. I guess it's probably been a year or so ago. And he preached about crying out to the Lord. Anybody remember that? Amen. And there were in this church people that took that word at face value and mixed it with faith and applied that principle. And God has worked in their life. And so we owe a debt to this man of God. It's going to be a great, great time. Today was a breakthrough. And I don't mean to tell the story, but it's just so exciting. It's Pentecost Sunday. He told me that for 6 years in England, they have been trying to get in the prison to preach. They've been trying for 6 years. And today, on Pentecost Sunday, the door opened up and they went in, and one of their ministers went in and preached, and two people received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I think we ought to rejoice for what God has done. Not going to want to miss. Amen. Our British brother will be preaching on Tuesday night. Lovely. Amen. Hallelujah. It's going to be great. Amen. We love them. Thank God for them. Psalm 68 and the verse number 1. Let God arise. Let his enemies be scattered. Let them also that hate him flee before him. As smoke is driven away, so drive them away. As wax melteth before the fire, so let the wicked perish at the presence of God. But let the righteous be glad. Let them rejoice before God. Let them exceedingly rejoice. That was in case you missed the first one. He said, let the righteous be glad. Let them rejoice before God. Yea. In other words, hey, pay attention. Let them exceedingly rejoice. Sing unto God, sing praises to his name, extol him that rideth upon the heavens by his name Yah, and rejoice before him. Amen. I want to preach, the title makes sense in a moment. I want to preach from this. This is the part we'll jump off in. There's so much to preach in Psalm 68. I can't get to all of it, but I'm going to preach from this portion, and I'm going to call it Building the Road of the Miraculous. Building the Road of the Miraculous. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Wouldn't it be great if you got a miracle? You ain't gonna get it with that kind of faith, I can tell you. I mean, I didn't offer you a Snickers bar. I mean, think about what you really need. I'm just playing, okay? I just call it like I see it. The Bible said, you have not because you ask not. And it is the Father's good pleasure to give gifts to his people. That tells me that God has miracles that people don't take advantage of. I'm not here to cross theological swords. I know we can get into 2 weeks of discussion about why it happened and didn't happen and so on and so forth. That's not what I'm here. I'm just here to tell you. We'll figure out the gray areas later. I'm just here to tell you my God can do anything. My God can heal. My God can save. My God can set you free from addiction. My God can change your life. My God can fill you with the Holy Ghost tonight. Amen. This psalm is an exhortation to God's people. And I know we know what to exhort means, but I took the time to get the official definition just so that we could all be on the same page. To exhort means to strongly encourage, or to urge to do something. But it implies that someone is pushing, or I like this, what the dictionary said, or someone is inciting. So, for all of you that don't like it when the front line tries to get you stirred up, for all of you that are more posh Christians, that want to be more dignified and meditate on the presence of God, this is not your song. Because this is a worship leader's job description. This is a psalm that is in there with the purpose to incite God's people to rejoice. There's other times that you're to Selah, chill, think about it, meditate. That's not one of these. This psalm is to stir up the people of God to strongly encourage, to urge to do something, and implies that someone, tonight I am that someone. If you're looking for my title, tonight I am worship inciter. I don't want one person leaving this room tonight without giving God some great praise. Well, I don't feel good. Praise Him anyway. I got the fight with my wife. Praise Him anyway. The kids are driving me crazy. Praise Him anyway. What are you doing? I am urging you. I am strongly encouraging you. I am inciting you to praise God. I want somebody that God has been good to. I want you to throw your head back. I want you to praise God. Give God a shout of praise.
Strong enough, we're not big enough, we're not wise enough to confront the issue.
under grace, and so we come boldly. But I'm afraid sometimes that we misunderstand the glory of God's presence. If it was not shielded in some manner, if it were not for grace, you better hope the presence of God didn't come in here. Because the unfiltered presence of a holy God, you and I would be unable to even survive in the presence of that God. This was the understanding that Israel had, that when God would arise, the very essence of his glory and holy essence would go before, and like a consuming fire, it would destroy the enemy. In fact, to look upon it was to die. In Exodus chapter 19, God told Moses, he warned Moses. He said, you tell the priests and you tell the people, they better not break through this line that I'm establishing and gaze upon my presence, because to do so is to perish. They understood that when God's presence began to move, that when his presence began to arise, to move forward in his plan or operation, they understood that those things that were not righteous, those individuals or those armies or those nations that were resistant to that holy God, would never be able to stand. So they would begin every battle with the cry, let God arise and his enemies be scattered. I came to preach to people today that are going through hard times, that are going through situations where you got issues and the evil of this world is pressing in on you. Your cry tonight needs to be, let God arise and let his enemies be scattered. Let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Deuteronomy chapter 9. Thy God, which goeth forth, is ever before thee as a consuming fire, and he will destroy. I'm talking about the presence of God. Hebrews, the writer, told us that judgment and the fiery indignation. Let me just tell you something. When God gets ticked off, when God does, like my daddy used to say, we get to cutting up in the car, we get to fight and argue, me and my brother or sister, and we get louder and louder and more rambunctious. And he would say these little, my dad never got, he never freaked out. He just kind of like, he just, when it got really bad, he just like was, it was deadline and you knew it's like stone cold killing. He would just say, I've had it up to here. And you knew if he had it up to here, you had it somewhere else. Let me tell you something. When God has had it up to here, he will come with his fiery indignation. I don't know how long you got to go through what you're going through, but you just keep talking to God. You keep reminding God about what you've been going through. You keep telling God, hey, I'm your kid. I'm your child. I've been going through this thing. At some point, he's going to say, I've had enough. Let God arise and his enemies be scattered. The power of his glory so devastated his enemies that the psalmist described it in our text. He said, it is like the smoke that is driven away by the wind. I want you to get that picture of your problem and the enemy that is attacking your life. When God comes with his fiery indignation, when God gets up, when God arises, he said his enemies are scattered like smoke in the wind. Man, smoke, we got a firefighter back there. Stand up, brother firefighter. He's fought fires all over California. Thank God. Don't give him a big hand. He saved your house, probably. Fire can produce some smoke that if you stay in it, it'll kill you. The smoke, the flames never have to get you. The smoke can kill you. Am I telling the truth? Smoke can kill you. But isn't it amazing And the writer said, the psalmist said, when God gets up and deals in his fiery indignation with the enemies of his people, it is like smoke that the wind drives away. That's what we need. We need the breath of the Holy Ghost to blow in here. Some of you came in here and you were choked out in your spirit. It was like you were sucking through a cigarette filter. You can't breathe. You're choking in life and finance and issues and addiction and frustration and confusion. What we need is God to arise in this house and let the wind of refreshing blow over your soul, blow over your mind, blow over your spirit. In other words, this isn't even a big deal for God. I know it seems so big to you. I know it seems insurmountable. It seems like you're never going to get the victory. This is easy for God. This is easy for God. It's like wax in the fire. It's like smoke in the wind. And he says, the wicked cannot, everybody shout, cannot. The wicked cannot abide in his presence. The enemies of God are removed by his very presence itself. I started to name this sermon the no smoking section. Because after he says that about all the wicked that are scattered and have to flee, and all those that hate the Lord, they have to flee. Then he starts talking about the no smoking section. The place of the abode of the righteous. In verse number 3, it said, but let the righteous be glad. Let them rejoice before God. Yea, let them exceeding rejoice. You got to get the picture. When God's presence starts moving, when it starts getting up, let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Remember that old song? Just picture, it's like jet engines start. It's just hovering. It's moving. That power that hovered over the face of the deep that brought all creation to be. That presence is getting up. I can hear hell say, uh-oh. Something's starting to move. Sister so-and-so just said hallelujah. I looked over and brother so-and-so, he's starting to shake his head a little bit. Oh, the presence of God is starting to move, man. They came in here confused. They got to find the way to church, but I just looked and a tear was rolling. You know what? God's starting to get up. God's starting to get up. Something's starting to happen. And all the enemies start heading toward the door. Doubt starts moving out the back. Fear starts moving out the back. Depression and oppression start slipping away. Because when God gets up, when God arises, his enemies are scared. I can't just stay there. I gotta tell you, that's all the smoking section. They had to get the smoking section, had to leave. But something happens with the righteous. They don't go anywhere. When God gets up, the wicked have to flee. But for the righteous man or woman of God, when God's presence starts moving, the psalmist said, let the righteous be glad. Let them rejoice. All the enemies start fleeing. Oh my God, there he comes. He's coming with judgment. But the righteous. I got to preach this because you would have responded better than that if you really got this. He said, yea, let them exceeding rejoice. Everybody say, be glad. That's the first part. When God gets up, the smoking section has to leave. But the righteous, the Bible says, here's what you do. Be glad. In the Hebrew, that is samach. S-A-M-A-C-H. Which means to brighten up. So all of you sad sack righteous, all of you depressed, a smile on your face because God's presence is getting up. What I've been going through it, that's why you ought to brighten up. You ought to just turn on the switch and say, as of right now, the light's on. It's party time. God's getting up.
Yeah.
package, but I don't want to. Here's the point of this message. Don't tell me you're tired. This is my third service today. And I feel like going on. I don't feel nobody's tired right now. Because when I get in the presence of God, I begin to call things that are not as though they were. I believe God can do a miracle in this house tonight.
Sing to the Lord, sing
to do a word study. I'm trying to figure out how do you ride upon the heavens. And then he starts talking about the wilderness in verse number 7. And I was amazed to discover that your King James Bible, the English transliteration, translates it heaven. But the original word was not heaven. The original word was A-R-A-B-A-A-H, Araba, like Saudi Arabia. It literally means desert. So what the psalmist was literally saying in the original text is sing to God, jump for joy, brighten up, sing praises to his name, extol him, which means to build up like constructing a road. Build up, some of you are going to get this right here, extol him, build up the road for him that rides upon the desert places. This is why when you get to verse number 7, it said, God, when you went forth before thy people, thou didst march through the wilderness. The earth shook. The heavens dropped at the presence of God. Even Sinai itself was moved. There was a shaking that began to take place. What he is saying is you're in a dry place. You're fatherless. You're in bondage. You're bound up. Things are locked up. You're in the driest place of your life. He said, brighten up, start singing, start jumping for joy, let God arise, and as you begin to sing, as you begin to jump, as you begin to rejoice and worship God, it's like you get a road throughout and say, God, I'm over here in this dry place. I know you're in that place of rest, but we're going to build you a highway, and we start building. Every time I dance with you, I'm getting God over here. I'm making a road for him to get to my truck.
Mississippi.
Let me start over. What you need for Trey is you need a path, a route, to get your product to those people that need it. You need a river, you need a stream, you need a road, you need a highway. God said, I can get it there.
Amen.
Amen. I'll let you. Blessed be the Lord, who daily loadeth us down with benefits. Even the God of our salvation. You're still not listening to the Southern voice, so listen to a Brit read it.
Blessed be the Lord, who daily loadeth us with benefits. Even the God of our salvation, Selah. Blessed be the Lord.
Shout, that thing's gonna get knocked over.